Hi, today I want to show you how you can render 3D models using text display entities. This method also works with dynamically generated geometry, such as 3D graphs or marching cubes. Let's start by rendering a unit square. We'll create a text display entity, change its background color, then set its text to a single white space character. Finally, we'll adjust the scale and translation so that it occupies exactly one block. Next, let's render a unit triangle. Unfortunately, display entities use affine transformations, which cannot turn parallel lines into non-parallel lines. We can work around this by overlaying three text display entities in this pattern. Next, to fit our right-angled triangle between three points, we'll define new coordinates with point 2 as the x direction, its cross product with point 3 as the z direction, and finally the cross product between the two axes for the y direction. With that, we'll create a unit triangle rotated to these axes. We'll scale it horizontally by 0.2x, then vertically by 0.3y. Finally, we'll shear it by 0.2x divided by 0.3x. Now that we can render a triangle, we can render anything. Here's a ray model I created in Blender. Like all 3D meshes, it's made of vertices, which are connected together to form surfaces. To render this in-game, we'll export the data as an OBJ file and triangulate the surfaces using the ear clipping algorithm. Then, we'll render each triangle like this. Each vertex has an associated image coordinate. We can use these to sample colors from the texture file. Since text displays receive the same amount of light regardless of their orientation, we'll have to shade the model manually. We can do this by taking the dot product of the surface's normal vector and the light direction. This gives us a number between negative 1, which is perfectly facing light source, and 1, which means facing directly away. There's also a younger variant, which I lazily made by scaling down the model. The final model uses 8,000 entities. I also rendered a few famous 3D models. Here's the Utah teapot with 28,000 entities. And the Blender Monkey with only 300 entities. For me, the much more interesting application is rendering geometry that is generated on the fly. Here's a 3D grapher based on one of the first data packs I made. Back then I would have used armor stands instead of display entities, as they didn't exist yet. Instead of rendering the graph with discrete blocks, I created a smooth contiguous surface by connecting all four neighboring points with two triangles like this. I programmed a few different graphs. There's also a paraboloid, a sine wave, and a saddle. You can change the domain and resolution using these two sliders. I also created a marching cubes renderer. These sample points scan the grid for solid blocks or air and return either 1 or 0 respectively. Then I generated a mesh using the margin cubes algorithm. I used barrier blocks since they are invisible. However, they generate these barrier particles while being held. To work around this, I created a red concrete item that gets immediately replaced with a barrier block after placement. You can get different shapes by changing the ISO value or by adjusting the sample grid density. I noticed that the marching cubes algorithm generates a lot more triangles than necessary, so I implemented a mesh optimization algorithm. In theory, you could optimize it further by rendering these rectangles with a single text display. More broadly, there should be many polygons that can be rendered with fewer entities. However, I couldn't really be bothered to implement this. If you're planning to implement this yourself, here's a few caveats you should be aware of. Firstly, this does not work well with transparency, as alpha values will add up where the three entities overlap. Secondly, shear matrices don't get decomposed consistently, and this can cause the shapes to flip over during interpolation. To address this, I manually flipped the X and Y axes if the right rotation changes by more than 45 degrees. Thirdly, to minimize these shapes tearing as they are interpolated, you should only ever use an interpolation duration of 1. To support slower animations, you should interpolate the matrices yourself across multiple frames. That's all I have for you today. I'm curious to see what you will do with this technology, and I hope to see you again next time.